Receive it all, Jesus. We're here for you. Let the woman with the alabaster box. We want our worship to rise like a sweet perfume as we pour our love all over. Come on, Toronto, help me sing it out. From here to there, worship is filling the atmosphere, both now and then. Songs of your love will never end. Sing all day and night. Worship rise like a sweet perfume. Yeah. I'll pour my love all over you. Let my worship rise like a sweet perfume. You got it. Reckless love tonight. So we sing. Come on, DJ.
The overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it changes me now. Fights till I'm found and leave tonight. If I could earn it, I don't deserve it.
Oh, on.
Of his word, the revelation
of who he
is. You're only here because of who he is. If you agree with that, come on, somebody shout this morning.
Welcome, welcome back.
Thank you.
shed, the body broken, the pain endured, the suffering. He did it all just for me and for you. We're the ones he saved. We come to worship. Everybody lift your voice and sing.
We present
just for me. Just for me. Jesus came and did it just for me. Just for me. Just for me. Celebrate your King this morning. Come on. Bless him. Bless him. Thank you. Thank him. Thank him. Jesus came and did. He did it just for me. Come on, lift your voice and sing. Just for me. Just for me.
Time, I want you to really think about it. Just for me. Oh, just for me. Jesus.
It's on yellow.
He did it just
for me.
Aren't you special? Lift your hand. Just for me. Just for me. Come on, you're talking about Thanksgiving. Let's give thanks unto the Lord. Because he did it just for me. I got up this morning and came out to do it just for him, because he did it just for me. Hallelujah. That's why we're in service, just for him. I didn't come to see you. You didn't come to see me. We came just for him. Come on, let's enter into his gates with thanksgiving. His courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. I said, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. And his truth endures to all generations. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, 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 oh. The herald comes from the Lord.
Class 7.
Oh,
oh. 6-1. One more time. 6-1.
Oh. While you're standing, would you give God a praise and welcome our streaming audience from around the world into the presence of the Lord, into this Sunday morning service? Hallelujah, hallelujah, our e-members, our cyber congregation, honor for our First Lady being in the house of God this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God is so good, you may be seated. First, give it all unto the Lord, who is the head of my life. To the pastors, saints, and friends.
That's so cool.
Give it up for our associate pastors in the house. Associate pastors, would you stand? We just want to honor you in your respective places. Come on and give God a praise for all our associate and assistant pastors. Our assistant pastor, Torrey and Sarah Jakes Roberts. God is so good to us. He has brought us from a mighty long way. When I think of the greatness of Jesus, all that is my soul cries out. Sometimes I'm in the grocery store and I can't say it out loud, but my soul cries out.
Big one, come on!
Sometimes I'm trying to
Three! Four! Two! Five. Back. We are the one.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm not talking about my shoes or my coat or my hat. I thank you. I think I'm not talking about my house or my car. I thank you. I think I'm not talking about my jewelry. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you for saving me. And you didn't do it just one time. You keep on saving me. Every time I get in trouble, you keep on saving me. Every time my body is rot with pain, you keep on saving me. Every time my children are in trouble, you keep on.
Not can you gain a bishop? Get the head.
Oh!
Woo! We out.
I can't help it. I have to give him the praise. I promised him if he saved me, I would praise him till I die. Hallelujah. I owe him the praise. This Sunday morning is just a down payment on a lifetime experience of praising the name of the Lord. Can I get a witness in the house? Can I get a witness in the house? Can I get a witness in the house? I don't need a spectator in the house. I need a witness. A fire by side.
Way to argue, Doc.
A Holy Ghost filled witness. I don't need a watcher. I need a witness.
What
is there anybody in the church this morning that came to be a witness? He did it just for me. Hallelujah, you're watching online, you ought to type it on the line. He did it just for me. Yeah, I'm a witness, I'm a witness, I'm a witness. Got several people I wanted to recognize this morning. We've got 25 cast members from the show, MJ, Michael Jackson, playing at the Music Hall in Fair Park. Would you stand? Would you stand? The cast. The cast is at the Potter's House. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Come on, you can do better than that. Make them welcome to the Potter's House. Going to play is a lot of work. Thank you, Jesus. You get a day off, you want to stay at home. But they came out to worship the Lord with us. And we're glad to have you in the name of the Lord. Can you say amen? I don't know whether to call him a visitor because he is the son of the house. Pastor Ontario Green is in the house. Would you stand? Would you stand? Let's give God praise for him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glad to have you in the service of the Lord. We had 22 candidates to be baptized in water this morning in the name of the Lord. Cold as it is this morning, you have to have a serious commitment to get in the water this morning. Come on, give God praise for those 22 lives that have connected with him through death, burial, and resurrection. Water is the watery grave, we used to call it, where we identify with the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord. For the Bible said, if we are buried with him in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. In other words, if you go down with me, you're going to come up with me, walking in the newness of life. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, yeah. I'm in the Word this morning. I'm in the Word. I want to ask the church to be in prayer for the family of Bishop Carlton Pearson, who's gone home, but his family is still in torment and pain, and grief is a difficult thing to carry. And I want you to lift the family up while they go through this time of bereavement. Somebody say amen. We're not that far away from 2024. We're close enough now. If God be merciful, we could crawl to 2024. Come on, say amen, somebody. God is so good to us. He's brought us from a long way. Oh, brothers and sisters, Kirk Franklin's in the house. Would you stand? Stand up, man. Yeah. God is good. God is good. Just finished that reunion tour. I went out to see it. Was it amazing? It was absolutely phenomenal. It was absolutely phenomenal. God is so good. He gives people gifts, makes you think you gifted. That's when you really perform. And when I started moving and everybody started. Have you ever been singing with somebody you thought you could sing? And the tape stopped and your voice kept going and you decided that wasn't really your ministry, like, you know, not exactly. Maybe you should do the spoken word. Say amen, somebody. I want to give a heads up again to for our viewers, for our streaming audience. Our church knows it very well, but our streaming audience, yeah, there's some streamers that's in the house. Do you not know some of y'all stream and be in the house at the same time? And then tell us a note, I'm in the church streaming. Glory to God. We're glad to have you. Any E members in the house? Glad to have you. Stand up if you're an E member and you're here in the city with us. Give God praise. We're glad to have you. Up close. Streaming is great, but ain't nothing like the real thing in the real atmosphere. There's something in the atmosphere that I'm not sure a camera can catch. There's an effervescence of glory that emanates out of the people of God. When we assemble together, things begin to happen in a mighty way. But I want to tell you, do not miss our International Leadership Summit. You do not have to be a pastor. If you're a leader in any form or fashion, you want to develop your leadership skills like never before. Never in the history of our country and our world have we needed great leaders like we do right now. And some of you have leadership in your spirit. It hadn't materialized in your life, but you're a leader anyway. They used to make fun of me in the church I grew up in. because they used to call me Minister Jakes. You know, look at Minister Jakes walking like he a bishop. What I'm trying to get you to see, that you are what you are before you get where you're going. And sometimes you're the only one that knows it in your spirit, but you've got leadership in your soul, and you don't want to wait till you get the title to get the training. So I want you to make every effort to be out. We've got every area of leadership, from corporate to church to spiritual, some of the preaching is warring, is getting out. I don't know no place you can go and experience Bishop Jakes, and experience Pastor Sarah Jakes Roberts, and experience Bishop Noel Jones. Come on, somebody, to have an opportunity to hear A.R. Bernard share the word of God as only he can do, and Pastor Bronner share the word as only he can do, all in one place at one time, where you can develop your gifts in leadership over auxiliaries, departments, families. Your family needs leadership. Your family needs leadership. It's different between staying together and leading the family forward. Leadership is determined by progress. I can't lead standing still. Every time I move forward, that's leadership. Come on, somebody. So a leader moves the dial. A leader steps forward. A leader is progressive. Do they have setbacks? Absolutely. Do they get knocked down? Absolutely. But no matter how far you knock them down, they're going to get back up again because they got leadership down in their spirit. Come on, talk to me, somebody. I want you to be there. I want you to be a part of it. It's going to be in addition to all of those other areas, we will be joined by leaders such as CEO of Girls Inc. of Metropolitan Dallas, Beth Myers, minority bank leaders. We've invited the minority banks out of, I think, about 175, there are only 35 minority-owned banks left in the world. We're bringing them all together to see how we can support access to capital in our community. Come on, somebody. You want to be there for that. The minority bank leader, Kenneth Kelly, CEO of Dallas Mavericks, Sent Marshall, who is a member of this church, will be with us. Dr. Cheryl Jackson will be with us. Give God praise. Stand up, Dr. Cheryl. Take a bow. The Senior Vice President of Diversity, Inclusion, and Community Engagement for the Dallas Regional Chamber, Latasha Heron Bruff, will be with us. Singer and producer Anthony Evans can sing his face off. He's going to be with us, and so many, many more. It's just so many good things going on. I don't know how to tell all of it, but God is doing so many mighty and wonderful things in the midst of his people. And I sense in my spirit that God is getting us ready for something. Amen. Sometimes when we look up on the stage, we think all the leaders are on the stage. But all the people on the stage started out in the pews. Are you hearing what I'm saying? How many leaders in the house? Every person who knows you're a leader in charge of something, making it happen, budgeting bills, going out there and getting it, doing what you do, fighting a good fight of faith, get up on your feet and tell your neighbor, I'm a leader. I'm a leader. I'm a leader. That means I'm responsible. That means I'm dependable. That means I can endure hardness as a good soldier. That means if you knock me down, I'm going to get back up again. Glory to God, I'm a leader. Come on, leaders, give God a praise. A kingdom of priests and kings under God. Glory to God. That's what the Bible said, that we are a kingdom of kings and priests unto God. We are kings and priests unto God. So don't you come in here this morning walking like this. Hold your head up and your back straight like the king and the queen you are. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. You're kings and priests unto God. We've been functioning as priests through praise. We're offering up the praise and thanksgiving, lifting it up before God as they did lambs and goats and bullocks and turtle doves and peace offerings and wave offerings. We are offering up hallelujahs and thank you, Jesus, and glory to God and lifting him up. And our praise goes up before God as a sweet smelling savor. Do you not know that God is sniffing your praise right now? You ought to give him something to smell right now, a sweet smell. The Bible says your praise is a sweet smell unto God. To God be the glory for the things, plural, some of them I can't tell nobody about, for the things. Some of them were personal things. Some of them were private things. Some of them were spiritual things. But for the things he has done, let's give him 30 seconds of praise.
Come on.
One, two, three.
Sorry, C sharp.
Oh, King. Oh, mighty warrior, mighty man, mighty fortress
two.
Is our God.
Up.
A mighty fortress.
Three.
A mighty
one
mighty
four.
Fortress. A mighty fortress.
One four.
Is our God.
Up.
That just means I'm safe in here. That just means I'm safe in here. That just means I'm protected in him. That just means that when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord lifts up a standard against him. A mighty fortress is our God. He's kept you safe. He brought you through. He brought you over. He brought you out. To God be the glory. To God be the glory.
Big one, come on.
To God be the glory.
Three.
God be the glory. God be the glory. God be the glory. God be the glory.
Three. Six. Two. Five.
Three.
One. Out.
I can't even praise him enough. If I had the tongues of men and of angels, I couldn't praise him enough.
Y'all don't want to do that.
If I could dance all night, I couldn't praise him enough. If I could leap over pews, I couldn't praise him enough. If I gave everything I had, I couldn't praise him enough. For the things he did that were priceless, he kept my mind when my mind was in trouble. He helped me to stand when people were hoping I would fall and give up. He strengthened me when I was weak. He encouraged me when I was discouraged. He loosened me when I was bound. He set me free and liberated me. To God be the glory.
Go. Hold on to that. Hold on to it. Let's do it. Same thing. 1-4. Walk up.
Oh,
strength. Slow, slow, slow. 2, 3, 4. Up, hey, up.
We have entered into the service of the Lord. In the Old Testament, in order to be a priest unto God, you had to raise lambs and bullocks and goats. And after raising them and feeding them for months and months and years, they would take the lamb and bring it to the temple to offer it up as a living sacrifice before God. They didn't text to give. They didn't write a check. They didn't reach in their wallet and hand a few dollars. They had to raise the offering from the ground up. Whether it was barley loaves or whether it was a scapegoat, it had to be fed a long time, only to be slain in the presence of the Lord. They understood that it is better to have a blessed 90 than a cursed 100. They understood that they couldn't have a crop if God didn't send the rain. They understood that they were at the mercy of divine interaction in order to be able to have something to barter with every day. Because we're not raising our wheat nor feeding our lambs, we have a tendency to think we got here by ourselves. We talk about sororities and fraternities and HBCUs and Ivy League institutions as if they made us what we are. But if God had not sent the rain, if God had not given you the nimbleness of mind and agility of thought to be able to do whatever it is that you do, whether you're digging ditches or building bridges or working with chemistry or dealing with technology, whatever it is that you do, God blessed you. Even if you're retired and you've got income coming in, God blessed you. God blessed you. You know how many people get old and don't have nothing? Have to move in with the kids? God blessed you. God blessed you. I'm not saying everything's going right. I'm not saying that nobody's talking about you. I'm not saying that everything in your house is going right. But God blessed you with a house. Somebody would love to have your problems. Somebody would love to have your problems. Their problem is they've got cold and they got to find enough shelter to cover themselves on the floor. If I can get some cardboard, I won't have to lay on the concrete. But God blessed you. You get in your bed and don't think nothing about it. Jesus. Turn up your heat when you get ready. Wrap yourself up and go to sleep and roll over like you are entitled. God blessed you. God blessed you. God bless you. You got a business? God bless you. You got a career? God bless you. David said, "What shall I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits toward me? I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord." This is the time where we not only function as kings, but as priests, and offer up our gifts before God, our sacrificial gifts, our income, our resources. We offer it up in part to break the curse over our finances, to break the curse to say, "God, no matter how much you bless me, I will remember you." If you're watching online, this is an opportunity to add legitimacy to your vocal praise. Vocal praise means nothing without sacrifice. You can say, "I love you," till your lips fall off. But if you don't act right, lip service don't mean anything at all. Love should have evidence. Come on, talk to me, somebody. This is the time. If you need an envelope, our PMTs are in the aisle to serve you. If you're watching online, the information is on the screen. I'm asking you to function as a priest this morning and bring your lamb and your goat and your turtle doves and offer it up before God. Turtle doves were the cheapest things you could give, even the poor people gave. If you brought a lamb, it costs you something. Don't give God something that cost you nothing and expect him to be impressed with your generosity. Because he is impressed. When I give a gift, it says something about me. I'm real funny about it. It says something about me. It says something about the level I flow on. I'm getting ready to offer God a gift. They're going to sing a song, "Bless the Lord." and then I'm going to come back and pray over your gifts as we function as kings and priests unto God. Get in on online, in every country, in every currency, in every time zone. Get in on it, because this is good ground.
That's flames.
Hey, what's going on, everyone? My name is Joshon Griffin, and I've had the privilege and honor to play drums in the band pit at Potter's House, Maine. And under the leadership of Justin Savage and Mike Robb, man, it's like a constant learning wheel, like, you know, not turning wheel, but learning wheel, you know, and it's been really cool, man, learning the different styles, man, the language, how to communicate, on both on and off of your instrument. It's just been really big, man. So the, experience has really been great. You know, it's a brotherhood up there, man. Those guys are amazing at what they do. And, you know, they want to do nothing but see you grow. And, you know, just kind of keep the ball rolling. So, you know, I've been really grateful and it's been fun. So definitely looking forward to, you know, the next time I get to sit in with those guys, man. All right. Peace.
As a sweet smelling sacrifice before God. He said, acknowledge me in all thy ways and I will direct thy path. If you're giving online, acknowledge him. This is how we acknowledge him. Every good and perfect gift cometh down from above, from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness nor shadow of turning. As we lift our gifts up before you, we do it with humility. We are not presumptuous enough to think that we can toss anything at you and it's acceptable. You're our God. You're not our taxi driver. You're not our Uber driver. You're not our waiter. We won't throw change. You're our God. Quite frankly, we look to you for the future. You're the stable place when everything is shaky. You are the solid place when all is in turmoil. Everything that can be shaken is being shaken, so that those things that cannot be shaken may remain. And we ask you to bless this offering and consecrate it to your glory. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. All the people said, amen. Pass your seat all the way down to the left. And prepare your hearts for the word of the Lord. Our PMTs are in the aisle. They're ready to serve you in the spirit of excellence. Without further ado, serve the people of God.
What are they going to
do? Yeah. That's a little bitty old sick weak praise. Come on, come on. Give that praise some vitamins. Come on. Give that praise some vitamins. We got to praise him this morning. Can you say amen, somebody? I have been laboring in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 through 30. My assignment today is to talk about the power of the blood covenant. Before we partake of the Lord's Supper, it's important that we understand the power of the blood covenant. I'm going to take my time with it. Don't rush me.
Take your time, Bishop.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. Here the Apostle Paul is writing to the church at Corinth. He has gone to Corinth to introduce and establish them in the faith. He is the apostle that is called on the road to Damascus, having served diligently in Judeo-theology. He now converts to Christianity. And change is not easy. I said change is not easy. And God has sent him to serve, for the most part, the Gentiles, many of which he would not have eaten with before he was converted. Lets us know that bigotry and racism is destroyed by salvation. Any salvation that doesn't leave you loving your brother is not legitimate. No matter what language he speaks, the color of her skin or his skin, their age, their intellect, their choices or their decisions, there ought to be something in you that does not think more highly of yourself than you ought. And God has sent him to Corinth, and now he is laboring in Corinth. And he says, for I received from the Lord himself that instruction which I passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. Whatever you did, that was helpful. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is offered as a sacrifice for you. Do this in affectionate remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant ratified and established in my blood. Wait, this cup is the new covenant. While he's writing the New Testament, he is saying this cup is the new covenant. So the covenant is not a document
It's in the cup. Look at somebody, say it's in the cup.
It's in the cup.
Do this as often as you drink it in affectionate remembrance of me. Now this is Amplified Bible. It adds the word affectionate, but it defines clearly the way God wants to be remembered. Not like you remembered where you put your watch, but with a sense of affectionate, meaning that God is monitoring your attitude and not just your service. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are symbolically proclaiming the fact of the Lord's death until he comes. Hold it. Wait. So every time I drink this cup, I am proclaiming the Lord's death that's behind him until he comes that's before him. My God. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in a way that is unworthy of him will be guilty of profaning and sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. But a person must prayerfully examine himself and his relationship to Christ. And only when he has done so should he eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without solemn reverence and heartfelt gratitude for the sacrifice of Christ eats and drinks, catch this, eats and drinks a judgment on himself if he does not recognize the body of Christ. That careless and unworthy participation is the reason why many among you are weak and sick. It's the reason why many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep in death. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, there is power in the blood covenant. Father, in the name of Jesus, let the anointing saturate this place as we delve into the word of God. Let it be made flesh in us and through us and with us and to us as we exemplify the embodiment of the word wrapped up in flesh. Let the word penetrate. Let it be grafted in. Let it become a part of us, not a personality we assume for one day out of the week, but a lifestyle that is coherent with our belief system is what we ask you for. Now, over the next few minutes, as we delve into the depths of your word, let treasure come out of the word and speak to us in a supernatural way. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the church say, amen. You may be seated. Many, many churches celebrate communion on the first Sunday. Every first Sunday, there's nothing wrong with that. Some denominations serve communion once a year. There's nothing wrong with that. In this church, we do it quarterly or so. There's nothing wrong with that. He didn't say how often. He just said as often as you do this. Do this in remembrance of me. I grew up in a church that served communion every first Sunday. And when I came in the church door, I knew it was communion because there was a big old, looked like a body in the front of the church. The communion cups were all covered, and the wine was all covered. And as a little child, when I walked in there, I thought it was kind of spooky because they would have it all covered over like a shroud, symbolizing that they had brought the body of Christ into the sanctuary. So when they unveiled it and began to serve it, I was made to understand that we were drinking the blood and eating the body of Christ. I understood it a little bit. I was scared of it a little bit. Because that last verse, whosoever drinketh unworthily, drink of damnation to the soul. For this cause many are weak, and many are sick, and many are gone to sleep. It gave me pause. Yeah. I had to think about that a little bit. I had to pray about that a little bit. I had to get on my knees a little bit, make sure things was good, because I didn't want to drink something that made things worse. Because that word unworthily kind of got me a little bit, because who can say that they are worthy of the body of Christ? Save you understand justification by faith, you would be lost from the premise of understanding what it means to be a partaker of the body of Christ. You have to begin with understanding, and I'm going to take you backwards, and I'm going to take you forwards, and then we're going to take communion. You have to understand the history of blood covenants. Christ alludes to it in the very controversial and ominous statement that he made that dissuaded many people from walking any longer with him, when he said, unless you drink my blood and eat my flesh, you will have no part with me. And the Bible said that day many departed and walked no longer with him, because it was a hard saying. But it was not a new saying, nor is it unique to Judeo-Christian theology, blood covenants. Go all the way back to human sacrifice amongst heathens. Native Americans enter into blood covenant amongst brothers by piercing the skin of each other and allowing the blood to connect is a type of blood covenant. African ritualism also supports a blood pact as a traditional way of putting an agreement into effect in some African cultures. It is generally used for serious agreements and considered a much stronger binding than a signature or other binding method. You don't get any stronger than blood. Blood is as high as you can get. Abrahamic covenant, when God enters into covenant with Abraham, he enters into covenant with him. And the Bible says that they had cut in two lambs and goats and bullocks and turtle doves, five different animals, and God himself walked through the blood and promised Abraham while he was asleep that he would honor his covenant down to his children. It was a blood covenant, a unilateral covenant, not a bilateral covenant. A unilateral covenant is when somebody bequeaths something to you without your participation. Abraham is asleep. So they didn't enter into a bilateral covenant. It is a unilateral covenant. I'll give you a contemporary example. If I go to my lawyer and I will something to you, you don't even have to be there to be the recipient of a covenant that does not require your signature. It is bequeathed unto you. It is inherited by you. You become the recipient of it without effort, because the onus is upon the giver, not the receiver. Oh, I'm preaching already. You must understand this grace that we walk in, the onus is upon the giver and not the receiver. The Bible said his right hand and his holy arm, we often misquote it, have gotten him the victory. It also says salvation is of the Lord. It is by the Lord's doings, it says, we are not consumed. His mercy is new every morning. If we took the whole service and danced the whole service, if we took all our earthly goods and our possessions like the apostles once did and committed it into the kingdom, we still could not get past what God gave us, when God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have everlasting life. And when I say I'm blessed because I am the recipient. I am the beneficiary. I have entered into a place of receiving something that I'd had nothing to do with. God did it all by himself. To God be the glory for the things he has done. My turmoil with the text, though, exists on the premise that the Apostle Paul has written this particular epistle, and he has written it to the church at Corinth. And he says that the Lord, he gave them the teaching because he had gotten it from the Lord himself. It was that phrase that had me stuck and studying, because how could Paul have gotten it from the Lord himself when Paul was a Christian killer? He was not in the upper room or at the Lord's Supper, and yet he says, I have gotten it from the Lord himself. He is the least of the apostles in terms of experiencing Jesus. The others had walked with Jesus for 3 years. They had seen Jesus turn water into wine. They had seen Jesus heal the woman with the issue of blood. They have seen Jesus do exploits that raised Lazarus from the dead. They had seen Jesus walk on the water. Paul was not there. Paul was not there when the woman with the issue of blood touched the hem of his garment. Paul was not there when the woman who was bowled over for 13 years and could in no ways lift up herself, straighten up herself. Paul was not there when blind Bartimaeus came over to him and got healed from his blindness. Paul was not there. And yet Paul has this great expositor of the mystery of the Godhead, the mystery of the so-called rapture. I say so-called because rapture is not a Bible word. It is inferred, but it is not expressed. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in the moment and in the twinkling of an eye. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and we who are alive and remain shall be, here's where we get the word, sister, help me preach this morning. We shall be caught up together with him in the air. Paul introduces all of this. Paul introduces most of our Christian theology without having been a direct disciple in the original choices of Christ. In fact, Paul does not accept Christ until Christ has been crucified. And Christ appears to him on the road to Damascus. And yet he has conveyed unto him the most powerful revelations that caused us to have most of our New Testament theology. And he gave some apostles, some prophets, some pastors, some teachers, some evangelists for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, till we all come into the unity of the faith. Came from Paul. Shall we continue in sin that God forbid? How can we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Came from Paul. For we know if this earthly house or tabernacle shall be dissolved, we have another building in eternal in the heavens. It came from Paul. Why did most of the revelation come from the person who had the least experience? Sometimes God will give you revelation into things that does not come into alignment with your experience. You know it. You just know it. You don't know how you know it. You just know it. You can do it. You don't know how you can do it. You can just do it. You weren't trained to do it. You didn't go to school to do it. But there are certain things that are wired into your DNA that God has gifted you to be able to do, that you know you can do it, and it doesn't make any sense that you can do it. And a lot of people don't like that you can do it, and they hate on you that you can do it, but you can still do it because the Lord has revealed it unto you. The Lord has shown it unto you. The Lord has expressed it unto you. The Lord has given it unto you. You are gifted. How many people are honest enough to admit that some of the things that you're able to do, you can't explain it, you're just gifted? Touch your neighbor and say, I've been gifted. With that gift comes a responsibility. If God thought enough of you to give you a gift, There has to be a certain level of responsibility that comes with that gift, that you be a good steward of that gift. What the enemy tries to do to the gifted is distract them with trials and temptations so that they don't walk into their legacy and understand who they are because they're gifted. What the enemy tries to do with the gifted is raise up and anoint people to hate you because they don't understand how they worked so hard and got so much less, and you did so little and God used you in such a mighty way. It's just that God gave it to you. The gift is the grace of God. The gift is the grace of God. I'm going to say it again for the people over here. The gift is, let me say it for the people in the balcony. The gift is the grace of God. The gift is the grace of God. And the enemy's trying to tell you, you don't have nothing to offer. And the devil is a lie. Everything you got is a gift from God. Somebody ought to shout me down. Shout me down. Here again in our text, Paul seems to have the greatest depth of insight and revelation about the Lord's table and the Lord's supper, and he didn't even have a seat at the table. Who can do that stuff but God? Who can do that stuff but God? Who can get you up to speed? You miss, you're 3 years behind. This Shandabo Koshai. You're 3 years behind, and God all by himself. Y'all didn't get that. Let me try that again. You're 3 years behind, and God just goes. And knowledge from God doesn't come through letters or words. It's just, you just know it. You don't know how you know it. You can't prove that you know it. You can't explain it to people, but you know that you know that you know that you know that you know. And if you're gifted, sometimes you don't even recognize that you're gifted, because gifted feels normal to you. It feels normal to you. That's why you have to have certain kinds of people around you who are not intimidated, so that they can reflect the glory of God, because sometimes you don't even know yourself how effective you are. So you can be gifted and be insecure, especially if you don't have people that are secure enough to reflect your glory. That's why God created man in the first place, to reflect his glory. God said, I want to see what I look like. And he made man out of the dust of the earth so he could see himself. And he could see himself in Adam until he sinned. And when he couldn't see himself, he said, Adam, where art thou? I can't see myself. Something has darkened the glory. You should be illuminating the Garden of Eden. If you got glory, you got light. When you walk into the room, you bring light into the room. Glory to God. When you got glory on your life, you have enlightenment. Enlightenment is separate from education. I'm a great proponent of education. That's why we have Jake's Divinity School. But education will never replace enlightenment. Paul is enlightened in a way that caused the other disciples to be a little off-putting toward him. Because when you really bless, people will cop a tune. They will get an attitude. They will resist you just because you're blessed and leave you scratching your head. What did I do to her? Why does he not like me? Why is he talking about me? You don't understand that light is coming off of you in a way. And men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. And some folks are just evil. You're trying to psychoanalyze it. Stop trying to psychoanalyze it. You're trying to counsel it. You can't counsel it. See, just evil. Just evil. Judas was just evil. He was the son of perdition. He was just evil. And evil people don't be shocked when they do what they are. Because evil people are going to do evil. And once you teach me you are evil, I don't expect anything to come out of you, for you shall know the tree by the fruit it bears. So I can't expect you to produce nice when your root is nasty. I just helped somebody right there. I just helped somebody. Somebody's burden just rolled away. So I don't know why you're sitting up disappointed because they act that way. How could they act any other way? They're acting that way because they are. I got something. You got something. We got something. We didn't earn it. We didn't work for it. We didn't labor for it. We stepped into it. Nudge your neighbor and say, I just stepped into it. I didn't earn it. I just stepped into it. I just stepped into it. I just stepped into it. I haven't been trained, didn't go to school for it. Just anybody know what I'm talking about? I just stepped into it. Sometime I was in it and I didn't even know I was in it. Until you told me the effect it had on you, I didn't even know it was even valuable. I just stepped into it. I can just fix cars. I can just build houses. I can just fix things. I can just do things. I can just make things. I just... Somebody's getting ready to... In fact, let's decree and declare. Shake hands with somebody and say, in 2024, I'm just going to step into it. Now, let me go further. Sit down. Let me go further. Now, communion did not become communion until Christ changed the meaning of the elements. The disciples did not go up to have the Last Supper in order to have communion. They were going up because it was the Passover. And so the meal that they ate and the experience that they had was centered around the Passover. We focus on the wine and the bread. But if you will remember, the Bible said, and supper being ended. So supper is not just wine and bread. But the wine and the bread is the part of the supper that represents the body and the blood of Christ. But before, it represented the lambs that were slain in Egypt for the exodus of the Hebrews from the bondage of Pharaoh. Okay? Are you following me? because I'm going kind of heavy today. Are you with me? Okay. The meal is called, the Jews would call it the cedar meal. It is a meal that is prepared on the Passover day. It is a particular meal to reflect the tradition of their escape. Their escape from Pharaoh came through the lamb and the blood of the lamb, because, write this down, freedom is a bloody business. Anytime you see freedom, somebody shed blood to make that freedom possible. Whether it is spiritual freedom, whether it is the freedom to vote, whether it's the freedom of the rights of women, freedom is a bloody business. Don't expect to wish yourself free. If there is no blood, there is no freedom. Sometimes you just got to fight. The kingdom suffered violence. The cedar meal. This is a meal that the Jews did to commemorate to their children, so that their children would not forget their ancestral suffering and sacrifice to bring them to the place that they're in. There are at least five foods that I jotted down and I wanted you to be aware of, just for your own headspace. Five foods that go into the cedar meal, okay? There's the shank bone. There's the shank bone where Jacob will smoke the shank bone. There is the egg, the new beginnings. There is the bitter herbs, the price they paid. There is the vegetables, the work they grew. And there is the sweet paste called Heraset, which made up the cedar meal. Every time they ate this meal, they reached back and connected with their experience with God that brought them out of Egypt. Everybody should have something that becomes your point of reference, that when all hell breaks loose, you can look back and remember, well, when I was in the hospital and they said I was going to die, God healed me. Or I was in a car wreck, or I almost lost my mind, or he brought me out of jail. There ought to be some point of reference that guides the trajectory of your life, because you're looking back at your life and you know, if it had not been for the Lord that was on my side, I would have been swallowed up. But thanks be unto God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. And you ought to have something to commemorate it, to celebrate it, to authenticate. Thank you. I couldn't say it for some reason. I don't know. My tongue just fell out my mouth. Authenticate the fact that you have been saved. It might not mean anything to anybody but you, but every time you look at it, it causes you to want to stand up and fight. It might be a picture, it might be a photograph, but everybody ought to have a testimony. And the interesting thing about the cedar meal is that the cedar meal was done so that the tradition was not lost with the transition of generations. The tradition is not lost by the transition of generations. They kept it alive by sharing a cedar meal. And Jesus is honoring the old covenant by going up there, as he always did on the Passover, to enjoy the meal. We don't talk about the meal, we talk about the wine and the bread. But the Bible says, in supper being ended in the Gospel of St. John, Jesus stood up, laid aside his garments, girded himself with a towel, and began to wash feet. You remember that? That's right after they had eaten the cedar meal. Many cedar places also have room for a sixth Hazoret. The sixth Hazoret is also important because it is completely bitter. The cedar meal is a central component of the Passover celebration. It lets us know, it let them know that they were liberated by God from the slavery of Egypt. Sometime you got to remind yourself you're free. Sometime you got to remind yourself you're free, especially when people try to dominate you and control you and tell you what to do and where to go. Sometimes you got to remind yourself, I'm a grown woman. I'm a grown man. I don't want to go. Why you not? I don't want to go. That's my why. I'm free. Somebody shout, I'm free. Somebody shout, I'm free. Somebody shout, I'm free. From the bondages that held me, from the past that constrained me, from the fear that intimidated me, from the demons that attacked me, from the witch that tries to hex me, from the generational curses that tried to bind me, from my habits and my past, from my proclivities and my weakness. Somebody shout, I'm free. Every time you say it, hell gets nervous. Every time you say it, demons tremble. Every time you say it, there's an earthquake in Hades, because the devil does not want you to know that you are free. When you know you're free, you don't need a Juneteenth. When you know. See, if you don't know you're free, you'll keep working like a slave because you haven't got the message yet that you are free. That's why preaching is so important, because it announces to the captive that the price has been paid on Calvary that purchased your freedom. And if you don't want to be a drug addict, and if you don't want to be a dope dealer, and if you don't want to be a whoremonger, and if you don't want to be a liar, and if you don't want to be a hypocrite, I just came to tell you what has already been paid for by his blood. I'm free. That's why they celebrate it with unleavened bread. I'm going to the last sentence. That's why they celebrated with the unleavened bread, because when they were in Egypt, they had to make bread with leaven. And they didn't want themselves to think of themselves the way they did when they were serving the Egyptians. So they celebrated with unleavened bread. In the New Testament, it takes on a new meaning. Leaven represents sin. But in the Old Testament, unleavened bread was rebellion against Pharaoh. There are some things that you do that's not even for you. It's for the one who held you. I dressed up to let you know I can. I dressed up to let you know I can make it without you. There's some things you do just because you want them to know. I never will forget a young lady told me, I'm your intercessor. And if you don't let me intercede for you, you won't be able to preach. I said, let's try it. Let's try it. I dare you, let's try it. I opened up the door and let her out the building and said, watch me. See if I can have power without you. See, once you know you're free. Oh, y'all ain't gonna talk to me this morning. But y'all, and you know you got some people in your life that didn't think you could make it without them. Don't you sit there and look at me all cross-eyed and funny looking. You know some people that when they walked out on you, they thought you was gonna die and you still standing where you standing. Don't you sit there and act like I'm not coming right up your row preaching this gospel. I'm preaching up in here, up in here. Liberation is to be celebrated. I said liberation is to be celebrated. You can't appreciate it until you've been bound. But if you ever been bound and you mess around and get loose, you're praising God for stuff people don't even understand. Your praise gets on other people's nerves because they've never been tied like you've been tied. They can't be grateful like you've been grateful. But if you ever been tied up, thought your life was over, thought you would die and go to hell, and Jesus broke the chains and set you free, it'll make you run all over this church. It'll make you leap out of your shoes. It'll make you dance with no music. Somebody give him 30 seconds of praise.
I broke up. Come on, come on.
Praise him like you know you're free. Praise him like you know you're free. Praise him like you know who you are. Praise him like you got a made up mind. Praise him like you're a free woman. Praise him like you're a free man. Let everything that have breath. One more thing about the cedar mill. Cedar mill done correctly in the Old Testament was four cups of wine, each representing a different stage of the Exodus story, because real deliverance comes in stages. It ain't no one cup experience. Real deliverance comes in stages. It's not a one cup experience, but it is a cup kind of thing. That's why Jesus said, Father, if it be thy will, pass this bitter cup from me. Come on, somebody. Freedom is a process. You don't get it in the first cup. You don't get up off the altar and you got everything you need to have. Some of you are trying to do four cup work with one cup experience. Now somebody say, drink again.
Drink again.
Yeah. The reason you don't drink again is that now you have one cup. Now you're going to judge everybody else going back to get more and more and more and more. You need to stop judging and keep on drinking, because God will fill you up. Woman, if you drink of the water that I have, you will never thirst again. The scripture said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. You say, well, I thought you was talking about wine. Why are you talking about Jesus? Turn water. God is going to take the dismal waters of your life and translate them into wine. Miraculously. And it's a process. You won't know when it happened. But somewhere in the process of being poured out, in the process of giving, in the process of serving, in the process of carrying heavy loads, in the process of helping other people, Jesus turns your water into wine. Go back and read the story. You can't tell when he did it. You just know that he did it. Have you ever got healed and you don't know when it happened? You just looked up and you just know the whole. That used to hurt. That don't hurt no more. You used to could say that and make me cry.
but I'm not crying anymore. I don't know when God died. Hey, Lord.
Whoa.
We're in three keys, gentlemen.
That was crazy. You
caught on. Kind of give all of the first couple was the arrival of the Messiah. The second was for the redemption of Israel. The third was for the liberation from Egypt. The fourth for the coming of the future Messiah. It looked, they were drinking forwards and backwards. Past, present, and future. Like the text, the Bible says, we do show forth his death, that's past, until he comes, that's future. There is an eschatology involved in communion that says, I'm just doing this till you come back. Jesus says, I will drink no longer wine till I drink it with you in the kingdom of God. You keep on drinking, waiting on me to come. I'm going to abstain until I come. And the next time we drink together, it will be a toast at the marriage supper of the Lamb, where the wicked shall cease from troubling, and the weary shall be at rest, and all the saints of the ages. Oh, hallelujah. Lift your glass up like you're toasting somebody. Hallelujah. When you hear that clink come from heaven, when there's a sound from heaven, when the clouds roll back, and when he who we have waited for suddenly appears, behold, the bridegroom cometh. The blood is my covenant. Say, the blood is my covenant. The blood is my covenant. It represents everything I needed. Before they picked up a pen to begin to write the New Testament, the Bible is clear that the New Testament, or the New Covenant rather, is in his blood. It's 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 in his blood. Everybody else that was crucified, they were dead when the Roman soldiers came to check them. But Jesus, when they came along, Jesus, they were alive when they checked them. When the Roman soldiers found them alive, they broke their bones so that they could not resist the nails and become obedient unto death. But Christ was already so obedient unto death that when they got to him, he was already dead. And the reason he had to be already dead is that he was the Lamb of God, and there was not to be a bone broken in his body. Hallelujah. Because he can't be a broken Savior and save a broken world. And they hung him high and they stretched him wide. He hung his head, and for me he died. So rather than to break his bones, they pierced him in his side. And the Bible said out of his side came blood and water. So when I talk about water, I'm talking about blood. When I talk about blood, I'm talking about water. Out of his side. Came blood and water. The atonement for my sins. The liberation from my past. So I don't have to sit up here and be at war in my head, because I'm free now. Let me announce to every battered wife, you're free now. Let me announce to every convict, you're free now. Let me announce to every drug dealer, you're free now. Let me announce to every pervert, you're free now. You might still be doing it, but you don't have to. He whom the Son hath set free is free indeed. You need to have your Juneteenth. Shake hands with seven people and tell them I'm free. I'm free. And then lay hands on yourself and say, I'm free. and watch the Holy Ghost touch your soul. Watch the Spirit of God stir you up. Watch God break your shackles. Watch God heal you of your shame. Watch God scrub out your guilt. He's gonna scrub guilt out of your spirit because you're free. Let the redeemed of the Lord. Let the redeemed of the Lord take.
What?
I don't want you to go into a new year with old chains. Before we get to the new year, we've got to have an emancipation service and liberate ourselves from all of this torment and all of this pain and all of this hell. Counseling is good. Therapy is good. But there's something that happens in the spirit when you know you are free. By the power of the blood of the Lamb that takes it to the next level. Anybody who's Holy Ghost free, show them how Holy Ghost free people. Yeah. Praise the Lord. This is what freedom looks like. This is what freedom looks like. This is how you praise God. When you know your soul is free, I am free. Praise the Lord. No longer bound, no more chains holding me. My soul is resting. It's just a blessing. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 I'm free. Tell cancer, tell leukemia, tell heart trouble, I'm free.
I wondered in my mind, when Jesus prayed about the cup and said, Father, if it be thy will, pass this bitter cup from me. The cup. It wasn't the death. It was the cup of sin. The cup of iniquity. The cup of our shame. It was bitter like the cedar meal. If it be thy will, pass this bitter cup from me. And the Bible says that he sweated till blood came out. And I just wondered in my mind if the blood didn't get in a hurry because he started talking about the cup. Because the blood of Jesus was the only thing that could atone for the cup of sin. For without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And just for a minute, the blood came out of his pores, said, let me at it. I'll tear that cup up. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that the Lord has done for me, he told the boys, sleep on.
The system is working. The system is working. When I said cup, I got blood. You can rest. And we have entered into the rest of the Lord. And the wicked have ceased from troubling. And the weary have been at rest. And we're not justified by works. We have entered into rest. Because the system works. The cup, here come the blood. No nails, no piercing, just blood. Coming through the pores of his skin. Anxious blood.
Yeah, black point.
Ready to redeem. Three times we see the blood. When they circumcised him on the eighth day in the temple, that was the first drop of the blood of Jesus to hit the ground. Again in the Garden of Gethsemane, when the blood rushed through his pores, as he began to contemplate the cup, the blood knew it's going to take me. And the third and final time was when they hung him on the cross and they nailed him to the tree. Hallelujah. And he started bleeding from the crown of thorns that was on his head and out of his right hand and out of his left hand and out of his feet coming together. They were driven together with one spike, showing that the Jews and Gentiles would come together with one spike of the gospel and forever be connected. But see, oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. But the problem with the story is there are only four nails. There are only three nails. One in his hand, one in this hand, one in 2 feet, and the only other piercing is the crown of thorns on his head. And that's only four. But five is the number of grace. So the Roman soldier, when he came up and pierced him in his side, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I told you in the Old Testament they drank four cups. So we got four on the cross. But when they pierce him in the side, we step from law over into grace. Tell your neighbor, I just stepped into it. I just stepped into it. I just stepped into grace. This grace that's on my life, God put it on me. This grace I got right now, God gave it to me. This grace I'm walking in right now, this blessing I got right now, this touch I got from God right now, God gave it to me. Hate on me if you want to. Somebody take a step. Just step into it. What you've been praying about for 2024, God said you're just gonna step into it. You're just gonna step into it. You're gonna step into a grace that's gonna forever settle them that are sanctified. When they pierced him in his side, not nailed him to the tree, when they pierced him in his side, the new covenant. Which brings us here. Which brings us to the transformative influence of the blood. And I'll close with this. When Jesus is at the table, they go up the stairs to have the Passover, to commemorate the Paschal Lamb of Exodus. For the first time in history, Jesus changes the trajectory of their lives by changing the meaning of their elements. He says, take, eat. This is not about your ancestors anymore. This is not about how they escaped the Pharaoh. For the Pharaoh they escaped is just a shadow of the Pharaoh you're escaping. You're escaping from Satan's grip over your life. And he says, take, eat.
The lamb was just a shadow of who I am. The Pharaoh was just a shadow of who Lucifer is. Now watch this. This is my body that was broken for you. But no bones in his body were ever broken. Because he would not suffer the Romans to break him. But he is broken in you from the physical body of Christ to the mystical body of Christ. He now breaks himself. No man gets to do this. I'm going to do this myself. He now breaks himself. I feel like preaching. I'm sorry, y'all. I'm going to quit. I'm going to stop. He broke. He came out. No man takes my life. I lay it down. If I lay it down, I'll pick it back up again. I'm not going to let them break me, but take, eat. So the physical body of Christ serves the memorial body of Christ to the mystical body of Christ until we wait on his return, which is the glorified body of Christ. Today, this is not just a ceremony. This is not just a routine. This is our alma mater. This is our Declaration of Independence. This is our cedar mill, reminding the enemy of what he paid for me to be free. Reminding myself not to be foolish with grace, but to take on the responsibility that he took on to redeem us from our sins. Join hands with somebody. Everyone standing. No one untouched. There is not a person in this room, on this stream, or who will watch this message in perpetuity who is not guilty. The person you're touching was in the cup. You were in the cup. Your weakest, most disgusting act was in the cup. Not just your acts of sin, but your attitudes of dysfunction. It was in the cup too. He paid the price to bring about redemption so that you might be saved. He drank your iniquity. Isaiah says he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And to all you sick folks, physically, emotionally, financially, with his stripes, personality disorders, bipolar, with his stripes. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying? With his stripes. With his stripes. We are healed. I knew a man that stuttered when he talked. And the Lord called him to preach. And the strangest thing about Pastor Johnson stuttering is that when he got up to preach, he never stuttered at all. Because with his stripes, we are healed. Moses thought he needed Aaron because he was a stutterer. But when he got before Pharaoh, God cut loose his stammering tongue. And with his stripes, we are healed. He never really needed anybody to talk for him. You keep thinking you need something you don't need to compensate for your insecurity.
Watch it.
Squeeze that hand. In Christ, you are whole. In Christ, you are free. Start setting up my table. In Christ, you've been delivered. In Christ, your shame is gone. In Christ, your brokenness is destroyed. Hallelujah! By his stripes! I know your father didn't raise you. I know your mother was a crackhead. I know your uncle abused you. But by his stripes! You don't have to wait on anybody to apologize. There are rape victims in here. There are people who were molested in here. And you've dealt with the shame for years and years and years. But when we lift this cup up today, by his stripes,
here with them carrying.
By his stripes.
I was on wheels.
By his stripes.
Please don't let this glass fall.
You're watching online. I told you to prepare your elements. By his stripes. You are healed. Look at your neighbor on the right and left and say, you're touching a miracle.
Touching a miracle. Comfortable they flat.
You're touching a miracle. If you want to know what a miracle feels like, you're touching a miracle right now. You've got a miracle in your hands right now. You've got a miracle in your hands. You got a miracle in your hand. You got a miracle in your hand. You have no idea what I've been through. You have no idea what I put up with. You're touching a miracle in this place right now. They're serving the blood. They're serving the blood. The blood of Jesus is free. If you're watching online, get your elements. Get ready. You can't use just anything. Hallelujah. There's some symbolism that's important. It is important that it come from the grape because he was crushed, not processed. Seven Up won't do this. He was crushed. It means something. It says something. It portrays something. It indicates something. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a praise.
I'm
goes to the hymn.
At the cross.
Somebody go there. Where's Mike?
Church, I can't hear y'all. On the
line. Stand 4-4.
Can't hear you.
Yeah. Oh, the blood of the Lamb.
Just be ready. She may switch songs again.
That precious blood. Amazing to me that Jesus now stands surrounded by disciples facing death, still serving. Not distracted, not depressed, not intimidated, serving Judas. What love! Yeah, you can't sing beside Sally. Not enough
to be a Christian if you're not going to be Christ-like. And on the night that he was to be betrayed, he took a whole loaf of bread and he broke it, saying, "This is my body that was broken for you." You don't think nobody loves you? This is how much I love you. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace is upon him. By his stripes we're healed. Pastor Torrey, pray the blessing on the bread.
God, we thank you for your incredible sacrifice. It's by your brokenness that we make it. God, as we take up your bread today, everything that would attempt to break us, since it is therefore broken in your body, we decree it broken off of our lives. In Jesus' name.
Sanctuary, let us all eat together. Thank you, Lord. And after the same manner,
never had a good one.
He took the cup, saying, "The new covenant is in my blood." Pastor Sarah, pray over the blood. When we pray over the blood, we're going to sanctify it. And before we drink it, we're going to raise it.
In those moments, we come into agreement with our fears. Sometimes we come into agreement with our insecurity. But as we drink of your blood in this moment, we say we come into agreement with the blood. We come into agreement with the blood over our family. We come into agreement with the blood over our health. We come into agreement with the blood over our finances. We come into agreement with the blood. And so as we drink in this moment, we thank you for the blood, that we have a new covenant to come into agreement with, and we break the covenant of sin. We break the covenant with our fears, our depression, our insecurity. We come into agreement with the blood. Bless this, Jesus, as you already have, and give us the strength to walk out what the blood has already bought.
Use this moment to examine yourself. When I lift this cup up, I bring devils down. Amen.
When I lift this cup up, I bring sickness down. When I lift this cup, I bring fear down. When I lift this cup, I bring cancer down. When I lift this cup, I bring every disfraction, broken part of your life under the blood. For the death angel said, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Father, we thank you. Let us drink together. Pick it up. There's power. There is
power. Power.
No more.
Wonder. Breath in the blood.
Hey, Black. Yep. Up in the
service. Go in peace. Go in health. Go in prosperity. Go in wholeness. Go singing. There is power in the blood.
Hey, Lord, wonders working. That was you, DeMarcus. Bitch, let's stop because of the bass line. It's all you, Doc.
I'm just playing.
Oh, there is power. Hey, Scott, can we unmute the background vocals? Of the land.
Need the background vocals on, Scott. Not on.
They say they gotta turn them on.
They're not on? Oh, they're not on.
Everybody's mics are on. Y'all asleep?
One more time.